Hello friends, welcome to my channel ELS, English Literature Studies with Gaur Harpreet. Today I will discuss one more poem by Robert Frost. The name of the poem I'm going to discuss today is Birches. In my last video, I've discussed about Mending Wall by Robert Frost. So let's get started with today's topic. Birches by Robert Frost. Let us discuss in brief about Robert Frost, who is one of greatest poets of the 20th century. He was born in San Francisco, that is in USA, and he has won the Pulitzer Prize for poetry several times and died in the year 1963, right? Robert Frost, he has his own style of writing poems in which we can say simplicity and charm. Both things are combined in his style of writing when he writes poems. Simplicity and charm is combined, and it has been said that he turned the living speech of men and women into poetry. We can say this is his characteristic, this is his main feature, which are basic of his poetry, right? And he believes that poems begin in delight and always end in wisdom, right? So let's get started with Birches. The poem Birches by Robert Frost. It is a poem that takes you into the woods and nearly up to heaven. It is one of the most popular of Robert Frost's blank verse creations, and it was published in 1916 in his book Mountain Interval, right? And the image of life through tribulation is the main focal point of the poem, and the second point of the poem is if it is possible for one that he could revert back to the simpler times of childhood, right? In my today's video, I will discuss only first point, and second point will be discussed in my upcoming video. So stay tuned. And in this poem, he portrays the activities of rural New England children climbing to the top of the birch trees and swinging to the ground. And also it portrays the images of a child growing to adulthood through the symbolism of this aging birch trees, right? And this is we can say through these images readers are able to see the reality of the life. They are able to see the reality of the world compared to their carefree childhood. And here Frost wants to be a swinger like this child, right? So that he may go up to heaven. In the starting said that this is a poem that takes you into the woods and nearly up to heaven. Frost wanted to be like this child. He wants to climb the top of the birches. He wants to swing to the ground. He wants to enjoy his childhood so that he may go up to heaven and escape from all the sorrows and troubles of earthly life, right? But he wants to come back because he thinks that the earth is the right place to live in. So this poem, we can say this poem ends in wisdom on a philosophical note. In this poem, Robert Frost stick to a single simple title with explanation of three aspects. What are these three aspects? Natural, personal, and philosophical. Why it is natural or naturalistic? Because the ice storm, it has its effect, which we are going to read in our poem today. That this the ice storm's effect on the birch trees is natural. It is due to nature, right? And then personal aspect means the boy is conquering the trees. That is personal aspect. Then philosophical, it is also philosophical. It answers philosophical notes because it shows the balance between reality and idealism. Birches, we can say it is a single stanza poem of 15-9 lines. And it is a blank verse poem because it is unrhymed and it is in iambic pentameter, right? And the language of the poem is entirely arranged through images. Although it contains some diction, it lacks sound devices, it lacks metaphors and similes compared to other published works, other works which are published by Robert Frost, right? And when we talk about this poem or we talk about Frost poetry, and then we one thing come in our mind, that is love of nature, his love of nature. Then his descriptive realism, his philosophical view and even imagery, in which we can say fact and fancy are combined. These are the qualities of Frost poetry, right? And he believes that poems begin in delight and end in wisdom. And all these qualities can be seen in Frost, this poem, Birches, right? And it is a nostalgic poem. Now let's start a poem. When I see birches bend to left and right across the lines of straighter, darker trees, I like to think some boys been swinging them, but swinging doesn't bend them down to stay as ice storms do. Whenever the speaker sees stooped birches trees, whenever I see birches bend, means stooped birches bend to left and right. Whenever the speaker sees stooped birch trees, we stand out against the surrounding upright trees. Across the lines of straighter, darker trees, these birch trees stooped and stand out against the surrounding darker trees and upright trees, right? And it seems to the speaker that they are bent this way because I like to think some boy has been swinging them. It seems to the speaker that they're bent because of a young boy who has been holding their thin upper branches and swinging to the ground. And this act of swinging on birches is presented as a way to escape the hard rationality of real world, right? As the boy climbs up the tree, he is climbing toward heaven and a place where his imagination can be free. The speaker knows that the swinging from the tree doesn't actually cause them to stay bent down, but swinging does not bend them down to stay as ice storms do. His speaker says that he knows that swinging from the trees doesn't actually cause them to stay bent down as the ice storms do, right? Often you must have seen them loaded with ice a sunny winter morning after rain. They click upon themselves as the breeze rises and turn many colored. As the stir cracks and crazes their enamel, as soon the sun's warmth makes them shed crystal shells. Most of you, he says that, the speaker says that often you must have seen them. Most of you have seen birch trees. The word loaded. Loaded with ice. This word loaded describes about the burden of being old compared to youth, just like the burden of the ice on the trees covered in ice on bright mornings, right? Loaded with ice, a sunny winter morning after a rain. this burden is compared to being old compared to youth, right? And just like the burden of ice on the trees covered in ice on bright mornings after winter's rain, birches like this scratch. These birches scratch against one another in the wind. The ice around the branches glinting as it begins to crack, right? And before long, they click upon themselves. They scratch against one another as the breeze rises. And turn many colored as the stir cracks and creases their enamel. I hope you are understanding what I want to say, that birches like this scratching against one other in the wind, and the ice around the branches begins to crack, right? And before long, the sun heats up the ice covered branches and causes the fine layers of ice to fall. And the sun heats up. Soon the sun's warmth. Soon the sun's heat. The sun's warmth heats up the ice-covered branches. Them is used for this ice-covered branches. Soon the sun's warmth makes them shed crystal shells. Soon the sun heats up the ice-covered branches and causes the fine layers of the ice to fall. Shattering and avalanching on the snow crust, such heaps of broken glass to sweep away, you would think the inner dome of heaven had fallen. They're dragged to the wooded bracken by the load, and they seem not to break. Breaking across the hard crust, that hard crust is due to avalanche, right? And due to the avalanche, the hard crust which the snow has created on the ground, falling and breaking of the ice, that one might think that some kind of sphere in heaven has shattered and fallen to earth. The birches get so weighed down by the ice, right? Shattering and avalanching on the snow, such heaps of broken glass to be swept away is a representation of final stage, we can say, in life. It represents final stage of life, and that is death, right? The shattering of the branches here is like the death of a person, and the sweeping away of the branches is like a funeral. Though once they are bought, so low for long, they never right themselves. You may see their trunks arching in the woods years afterwards, trailing their leaves on the ground like girls on hands and knees that throw their hair before them over their heads to dry in the sun. The birches bore down due to weight laid upon by ice on them. So low for long, they remain there for long. They never right themselves. They bow down for a long period. You may see their trunks arching in the woods, right? They bow down due to weight laid upon them by the ice, and they never break under this strain. They also never return to their previous height after having been bent for so long, right? They never right themselves. Never return to their previous height after having been bent so long. And this is the reason passerby will notice such trees curving toward the ground. They have been bowed down, right? They have been bent for years, and their leaves hanging down in a beautiful way. You may see their trunks arching the woods year after, and trailing their leaves on the ground like girls on hands and knees that throw their hair before them over their heads to dry in the sun. Their leaves hanging down in a beautiful way, as we can say, hair of girls might drape from the heads when they toss it forward, while on their hands and knees, leaving it to dry in the sun. This is nature at work. This is nature making the birches bow their heads to touch the earth in a rather beautiful fashion. It seems like girls might drape from the heads when the toes is forward, while on their hands and knees, and it is the work of in nature, right? Making these birch trees to bow down their heads to touch the earth in a beautiful fashion. In next lines, the speaker turns to the original focus of the poem, right? That is the second view of point, and that will be discussed in my upcoming video. So stay tuned, and if you like the content, please hit the like button, share and subscribe my channel. And if you are new to my channel, please hit the bell button so that you can get notifications for my upcoming videos. Thanks a lot for watching.